We now request our director, Uttara ma'am, to address the gathering.
Thank you so much, Rev. Namaste to everyone. I hope I am audible. Sonali ma'am, am I audible? Because
yes,
I am having
ma'am.
Some
Namaste.
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 Namaste, beta. Namaste to everyone. Namaste, Vivek sir. It's such a pleasure, Mr. Menon, to have you with us today. And we've been waiting very eagerly to hear you because the animal that you are so passionate about is an animal who at our schools is almost nurtured because we have... Sonali, can I be unpinned? Is that possible? And can we
yes,
stop
ma'am.
This? If that, yeah, that is so much better, I feel, because I can see, sir, and I can see all of you. So, sir, you'll be very happy to know that in all our schools, we have these big elephant models that we were gifted thanks to Madhu ma'am. And the children just love the elephants that are present in all our schools. So I wish we could keep a real one, but the models, you know, kind of symbolize to the children what and the importance of the elephant. And I find it very ironical that while we celebrate the festival tomorrow and we make modaks and we pray to a statue, the real gods that roam the earth are neglected. So today, my only humble appeal to everyone present on Facebook and in this meeting is, Beta, do something for nature that is around you. Do something for nature that is there present in every single thing that you do, in your own breath, you know. Let's not only idolize nature as gods. Yes, it's wonderful. We pray to Ganesha and whatever our religions, we must honor them. But the biggest religion of all is nature in its beauty, in its entirety. So my only humble appeal is that tomorrow when you celebrate Ganesh Utsav, do something, whether it is just a prayer, it's a donation, it's something towards nurturing the real elephant on this planet. That's my humble appeal. And sir, we are really looking forward to your talk. Like Sonali told you, we visited Tennessee yesterday and we saw so many elephants there. It was wonderful to virtually be able to do that. You know, we visited the sanctuary there where we were told about how elephants who are in circuses and who have no homes are nurtured. And it was a wonderful experience. So I think the children have already got a little bit of a background there and we are hoping that you will be able to, you know, push that last bit and actually create that awareness in them. A very warm welcome to you and of course to all my colleagues from across India who are here with us today. And to you children, you are very, very lucky that you get to listen to Sir today, sitting in your homes. You're very blessed. So thank you so much for doing this for us, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Uttara ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Elephant conservation is vital as it balances the ecosystem. More than 500 human and 100 elephant deaths take place each year due to the conflict between man and elephants. Although new elephant reserves have been declared by the government, elephant corridors have been identified in the past few years, and elephants have also been included in the Convention on the Conservation of Migratory Species of Wild Animals to ensure better conservation. There is a lot yet to be done, and much of it is in our hands. This year, the Sri Paryavaran Utsav 20 is titled Gajotsav, in honor of the elephants for whose conservation we stand in support. We are honored to have with us today Mr. Vivek Menon, who is joining us virtually from Kerala. Apart from being the founder, executive director and CEO of the Wildlife Trust of India, as well as senior advisor to the International Fund for Animal Welfare, Mr. Vivek Menon is a wildlife conservationist, environmental commentator, author and photographer with a passion for elephants. He has been part of the founding of 5 environmental and nature conservation organizations in India and the winner of the 2001 Ruffid Award for International Conservation for his work to save the Asian elephant. It is indeed a privilege for us to have you with us today, sir. We will have the question and answer session after Mr. Menon completes his talk. Sir, we welcome you to take the virtual stage now.
Thank you, Uttara. Sonali ji, Annapurna ji, Madhu ji, Uttara ji, all my young friends, all the other teachers and principals of schools who may be joining in, who I may not know. It's a great pleasure for me to talk to all of you right in the middle of a week which started with the International Elephant Day a little more than a week ago. And tomorrow, as many people have already mentioned, is Ganesh Chaturthi. So one global celebration for the elephant and one national. But when we look at this animal, we need to first understand what the animal is, and we need to figure out what we can do, as many of your principals and directors have already said, to help it. So what I'm going to do is to take you through in about half an hour on one particular aspect of the Asian elephant. But I'll start with the elephant first, and then I'll go to that one particular aspect which I consider today the biggest problem that the elephant is facing, and where I think we should focus our energies in trying to conserve the animal. There are many things that threaten the elephant, but this one thing, rite of passage, is what I want to focus today's talk on. So I'll try to open the presentation now, if you'll allow me for a second. Yeah, I hope that is visible to everybody.
Yes, sir.
Okay, excellent. So we start. So before we start the thing about rite of passage, first question is what the elephant is, right? So if I were in school with you, I would ask you the question, what is the largest terrestrial Indian mammal, which all of you know is an elephant. So that should be an easy one. But if I ask you the next question as to how many elephants are there in this world, people might often not know the answer. And many people normally would say two elephants, the Asian elephant and the African elephant. When I was in school, I was also taught the same thing, that there's an Asian elephant and there's an African elephant. Now, even if you consider it at that level, do we know the differences between the Asian elephant and the African elephant? I don't know whether people can speak on this thing. But there are several differences, yes, that people... Yes. Can somebody try?
Can I try?
Yeah, sure.
I think they have an ear difference.
An ear difference. Okay. Anybody else?
May I try? Sir, Asian elephants do not have a tusk, but the African ones have tusks.
Asian elephant do not have tusks. Okay. I've just shown you a photograph of an Asian elephant with tusks. Right?
So we have a few hands raised.
African elephants are much bigger than Asian elephants.
African elephants are much bigger. Okay. Anyone more?
Sir, there is a difference between their trumpets.
Their trumpets or their trunks is what you mean. Okay. All right. So some of these are correct. Some of these are not fully correct. Let me tell you the differences. Okay. One, the most easy way to tell an Asian and African elephant apart is the back. The Asian elephant has a domed back, right? A convex back, like a dome. The African elephant has a saddle. It has got a depression in the middle of the back. Now, it's very often felt that African elephants are bigger than Asian elephants. It's not always true. Yes, the biggest African elephant is bigger than the biggest Asian elephant. But on average, many Asian elephants are the same size as African elephants. In fact, Asian elephant females can be larger than African elephant females, right? So do not look at size. Look at the back, and in 1 minute, you know which elephant you're looking at. But somebody also talked about the ears, and it's true. There's a difference in the shape of the ears, okay? The Indian elephant or Asian elephant ear looks a little bit like the map of India. I mean, without Kashmir, but a little bit, it's like peninsula in India hanging down. The African elephant is more like a fan. Maybe a little more like a shape of Africa. Yeah, so that's a very broad way. Also, remember the trunk in the African elephant is heavily ridged. Can you see the ridges on the trunk? So it's heavily ridged. The Asian elephant has a smoother trunk. But more difficult is to see the trunk up close. If you see the trunk up close, you will find that the Asian elephant has two fingers, one on the top and one at the bottom, whereas the African elephant has only one. Okay? And then, of course, if you look at the teeth, you'll also know a difference, which you don't need to know. But anatomically, African elephant is called loxodonta because it's called lozenge tooth. It's a lozenge tooth. Whereas the Asian elephant is Elephas because it's got a ridged tooth. That is not for you to look at because you're not going to ask an elephant to open its mouth and look at it. But the other thing that somebody tried, somebody said that the Asian elephant does not have tusks. Not fully correct, but halfway there. In the Asian elephant, the females do not have tusks. So you see the mother and baby at the bottom? The mother and baby of the Asian elephant on the right, the mother does not have tusks. It has little small teeth coming out called tushes. These are hollow ivory pieces, but they're not tusks. They're not long, they're not sharp, they're not pointed, they do not go down. Whereas African elephant, male and female, can have big tusks, can have very large tusks. So do not look at the tusk and think it's a male. Okay? So these are the main ways to tell an African and Asian elephant. I don't want to confuse you further, but today genetics tells us that there are two elephants in Africa. There's a forest elephant and a savanna elephant. And now genetics is about to tell us that there are probably two elephants, at least in Asia. At the moment, we call them subspecies. The Bornean elephant and the Sumatran elephant are subspecies of the peninsular elephant, as well as there's another subspecies in Sri Lanka. But there is possibility that Sumatran and Bornean could even form species of its own. So the largest living being on Earth, we don't even know how many kinds there are, right? But one of the easiest ways of defining an elephant, which when I'm talking to you people as children, but when I'm talking to presidents or prime ministers or ministers of many countries, I still tell them the same four words. An elephant is a big, social, nomadic, and intelligent animal. If you know these four words, you know an elephant. Okay? If you know the fact that it is big, which all of you know, any child, even a primary school child, will tell you an elephant is big, right? Which is why it is so much on our conscience, because it's big. But it's also relatable to the human being, because like human beings, they're very highly social. I come originally from Kerala, where I am at the moment, but I live in Delhi. For most of my life, I've been in Delhi. But I come from Kerala, from a society which is matriarchal or matrilineal. Okay? The elephant is also matriarchal. The mother or the female leads the group and is extremely social. It is also very intelligent. If you look at an elephant's intelligence neurobiologically, I would say it's more intelligent than many of my friends. Yeah, it's very, very close to us in intelligence. It is also nomadic, or it moves from place to place in a fixed manner, in a cyclical manner, because it is large. So because you know it's large, you know it's nomadic. It is large, so it has to eat a lot of food. If you look at the elephant's requirements of nearly 100 to 150 kilos of food every day of a number of different species, you cannot just give it rice, you cannot just give it bananas, and it needs a lot of water every day. So if an elephant needs to eat that much, a herd needs to eat that much and drink that much, it will finish the forest unless it moves. So biologically, the elephants eat, move, the forest regenerates, and come a season, they come back. So that is the biology of an elephant. So the most important thing for you to know when tomorrow you children grow up and become managers and administrators is that the elephant should not be settled. Okay? There are people who think, oh, elephants should remain in the forest and we should remain outside and we should not allow the elephants to move. No, you cannot do that. That will be havoc to the land and havoc to the animal. You have to allow the elephant to move between forests in a coordinated and safe manner for them and for us. More of that later. But to us, I mean, your directors and principals talked of the elephant as an object of worship for definitely 80-odd% of Indians. For the Hindus among Indians, it is an object of worship, right? It is Ganeshji. It is also a target of hunters or poachers or people who kill it because they come into conflict. It is also, to a large number of people, considered a burden. If you ask a forest manager or chief wildlife warden, he'll say it's a headache. Why? Because elephants are killing 400 to 500 people a year. They're destroying crops. And so people feel in this country today that the elephant is becoming a burden. Because it is a god to so many Indians, because there's such a cultural connotation, it is still not as much of a burden to the Indian as it is to many other parts of the world. In Africa, it is definitely considered a problem. We also have a deep cultural connection with the animal, including keeping it in captivity. Remember, children, there is nothing called a domestic elephant, even if your teachers teach you that. Okay? All elephants are wild, but some of them are kept in captivity with chains on their feet. Were they domestic, their genes would be different from the wild animal. Like the wolves are wild, the dog is domestic. The tiger is wild, the cat is domestic. But the wild elephant is the same in the wild and in captivity. And that's why you put two chains on its feet and keep it, right? This, whether good or bad, has been a feature of India and South Asia for nearly 3,000 years. Okay, at least 3,000 years we have been keeping animals in captivity, elephants in captivity. In the old days, it was used for royal purposes and later became logging, then became used for war for some stages, and then now, of course, used for tourism. Okay. However, for a conservationist, for all of you, you must also understand the elephant is a keystone species. If the elephant thrives, the forest thrives. And here are some ways in which the elephants actually affect the forest. I'm not going into detail of all of these. You can read it also. But for me, the elephant is an architect of the forest. The elephant creates pathways. The elephant creates water holes. The elephant puts in dung that actually allows things to grow, right? So the elephant actually opens up sometimes woodlands and creates grasslands. It is the animal that can actually, being a mega herbivore, shape a forest, create a forest. Now, Asian elephants in the past used to roam between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers in modern-day Iraq and Iran, and all the way up to eastern China. Okay? But today, you can see these small little patches of orangish-red, the rust-colored patches in the green. That is all where the elephant is. So see how much it has shrunk. Okay? Remember, we have about 50,000 elephants in the wild. Okay? 48,000 to 51,000, so 50,000. You must also know that there are nearly 1.5 million African elephants, perhaps 2 million African elephants. So when we say the African elephant is endangered, you watch Discovery, you watch Animal Planet, you see the African elephant is in danger, well, then the Asian elephant is in real, real trouble because there's only 50,000 of them left in 13 countries. If you see India, it's found in four pockets. So it's found in the Western Ghats, where I am. I'm at the moment in this little V shape that you can see. I'm right at the middle of that V between Tamil Nadu and Kerala, right? And here we have about 15,000 elephants. Then in the Northeast, again, we have more than 10,000 elephants, primarily in Assam and Arunachal, but also in a few other states like Meghalaya. And then there are two smaller populations, one in what we call central India, but is actually eastern India, southern Bengal, Orissa, Jharkhand, etc., Chhattisgarh. And also northern, in a small area in the Terai, where Corbett Park and Rajaji Park are close to New Delhi, close to your school, where you probably have gone, I hope some of you have gone at least, in Uttarakhand and spilling into Uttar Pradesh and then crossing over to Nepal. You all know this. Everybody knows that there's a lot of threats to the elephant. And it's largely because we share 1.3 billion people share the same landscape as elephants. Okay. So these sort of scenes that you see in newspapers and media is happening every day. I'm going to come into more detail on that. In the early 90s, I worked a lot. Some of you, I mean, I think in your introduction, you talked about the award I got in 2001. Well, that was for my work on ivory trade. And for a long time, I worked undercover in Japan and China and trying to find out why our elephants are being killed. Okay? And that was ivory. And at that time, I thought ivory trade was the most important thing that is threatening our animal. No longer. In the late 90s, we managed to curb it. Early 2000s, we managed to curb it. Today, not that poaching doesn't happen. Poaching happens. But that's not the biggest threat. The biggest threat to me is habitat loss and fragmentation, which means that elephants are not only losing their home, but their ability to move from one place to the other. Not because of corona, yeah, but not because of quarantine, but because they're not being able to reach where they need to reach. Because of our linear infrastructure. And a very interesting fact all of you should know, when the British came to India and laid down the first roads, where did the British lay the roads, especially in hilly terrain where they could not know where to put the roads? They followed elephant footprints. Because the British engineers were good engineers, and they realized that wherever the elephant puts its foot will be the most stable gradient. Okay, very good engineering. But what happened? The roads came in the path that the elephants have been taking for 3.5 million years. Approximately 3 to 3.5 million years, elephantoids have existed in India. Remember, we Indians have come into the picture only 50,000 years ago, 60,000 years ago, something like that, humanoids. But definitely not 3.5 million years ago. Yeah, people have different aging categories of humans in India, but not clearly 3.5 million years ago. So clearly, elephant is an older Indian than any of us. And railway tracks, anything that's linear, which means goes in a straight line and cuts the habitat into two. This is a problem for the elephant. Yeah, these are no longer animations that we are showing you. These are real images that people are managing to photograph on their iPhones and sending it to us. Or any phone, not just iPhones. You can see that we have been in Wildlife Trust of India monitoring elephant deaths, whether due to trains or highways or other forms. And we see that there is a generally growing trend in a large part of the country. Not everywhere, but in a large part of the country. For example, in train, Assam and West Bengal has a large amount of it. And not just trains and highways and all, but tea and coffee plantations long ago made, not anymore, but long ago. Agriculture, crop cultivation still happening. So large areas going. And therefore, the famous tolerance of Indians, our fact that it's Ganesh is no longer there in most parts of India. So this picture on the left, which won a photographic award for Biplab Hazara, shows in West Bengal people throwing fireballs at the elephant. And people running towards the elephant, running away from the elephant, and getting killed in the process, and killing elephants in the process. This is a daily thing, unfortunately. So tolerance is not forever. Don't think, oh, we think it's Ganesha, so we'll allow this elephant to stay. So I told you 400 to 500 human deaths a year, 100 elephant deaths a year, about 500,000 families affected, 1 million hectares of crop damage. This is a real problem, a real problem. Okay. So the long-term solution to any of this, because the elephant is big, it needs to move. Because it needs to move, you need to allow it to move from point A to point B. If you see on the left, you can see how the elephant moves from point A to point B using a small narrow strip of land. What is all that yellow? It's human beings. So where there are dense human populations, you cannot move. So you have to move between in the green, which is forested land. Okay. So we have been trying to protect this forest along with the Ministry of Environment and Forest and all state forest departments. And I will not go into great detail of telling you, but it's very, very important, not just for these animals to move, but also for the genes to move. Otherwise, eventually, these elephants will become little pockets of isolated animals, which are frustrated, which will kill people, as well as their genetic viability will go down. Remember, when we say elephant corridors, it's not just elephant corridors. We put up signs all over saying elephant corridors. But tigers also use it. They don't read English. They don't read Hindi or Malayalam, but they use it. And so do frogs, so do bats, so do other animals. So corridors are, we are using elephants, but really it is meant for all animals. And this little animation, if you people can see it play, it's about 5 minutes, will tell you exactly what a corridor is. And then I'll tell you something.
So there's no audio.
No audio.
Yes.
Can you'll I?
Have, you'll have to unshare and share again. Probably tick the audio input box.
Oh, I see. Okay. Now comes my issue of.
So the taskbar.
Yes, I stopped sharing, and then I'm going to share again.
Great.
And I'm not seeing that thing of saying.
So you'll have to hover your cursor on the screen. You'll see the taskbar.
No, I can see the taskbar, but I'm not seeing where the audio.
Okay. Have you clicked the share button? It'll pop up. It'll pop up then. The audio input.
No, it did not pop up.
Let's try it so then.
No.
Sometimes it says include system audio.
Yes.
Sir, it's on the top left corner.
Top left corner?
When you open the share, when you click the share button.
Yeah.
It will pop up on the left corner.
Oh, yeah. Okay, found it. Sorry.
Great. Thank you, Rev.
My mistake. You always need a younger person to tell you how to do these things.
Absolutely, sir. Thank you, Rev.
Travel
kaise kar rahe hain
office ke liye, school ke liye, ya apni girlfriend se milne ke liye? Train lete hain. Aap roz travel kaise karte hain? Office ke liye, school ke liye, ya apni girlfriend se milne ke liye? Train lete hain, mummy ki scooter ya papa ki nayi BMW? चलो क्या फर्क पड़ता है? Railway tracks हैं, रास्ते हैं, highways हैं, किसी ना किसी तरह पहुंच ही जाएंगे. जस्ट इमेजिन कि किसी सुबह आप उठे और आपने देखा कि सारे रोड्स और सारे हाईवेज घने अंधेरे खतरनाक जंगलों से भर गए जंगली जानवरों के साथ. सो व्हाट विल यू डू नाउ? विल यू स्टाफ टू डेथ? ऑफिस और मॉल नहीं जाओगे? कॉलेज नहीं जाओगे? नाराज करोगे गर्लफ्रेंड को? ना, आप रास्ता बना ही लोगे, है ना? और अगर उसके लिए लोगों को इकट्ठा करके कुछ पेड़ काट के कुछ जंगली जानवरों को मार के आगे बढ़ना पड़े तो वही सही. डोंट वरी, अगर आपका जवाब हाँ है तो आपको कोई गलत नहीं समझेगा. ये तो नॉर्मल है. हम इंसान एक जगह ठहर नहीं सकते. जब से सिविलाइजेशन और एग्रीकल्चर शुरू हुआ है तब से हम एक जगह से दूसरे जगह ट्रैवल करते गए और सेटल होते गए. रिसर्च और डिस्कवरी करने की आदत हमारे एवोल्यूशन के लिए काफी इम्पोर्टेंट है. हम एक रिसोर्स से भरे जगह को चुनते हैं और उसको तब तक यूज करते हैं जब तक वो खाली नहीं हो जाए और फिर हम और आगे बढ़ते हैं किसी नई जगह के लिए. पर ये सिर्फ हम नहीं करते, दुनिया में कई ऐसी स्पीशीज हैं जो इस तरीके से अपना गुजारा करते हैं. जी हाँ, दूसरे स्पीशीज भी अपने रास्ते में आने वाले हर चीज को बर्बाद कर देते हैं. और यही बात हमें एक अजीब रियलाइजेशन पर लाती है कि क्रिएशन एंड डिस्ट्रक्शन आर टू साइड्स ऑफ द सेम कॉइन, जो प्लैनेट अर्थ के लाइफ के लिए उतने ही इंपॉर्टेंट है. अब अगर एक इंसान जानवरों की तरह अपने आसपास की चीजें इतने हद तक क्रिएट और डिस्ट्रॉय कर सकता है तो सोचो एक हाथी कितना कुछ कर सकता है. हाँ, हाथी, वो जानवर जिसका चेहरा एक हिंदू देवता से मिलता है, जिसे हम हर काम की शुरुआत में पूछते हैं. वही जानवर जो एक जायंट है पर वेजिटेरियन भी है, वो जो कभी नहीं भूलता और जो हाथी मेरे साथी में था. सो क्यूट. हाथी वेजिटेरियन होकर भी एक बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट स्पीशी है, क्योंकि नेचर में उनका एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट रोल है. वो जंगलों को बनाते हैं. दे आर द क्रिएटर्स. बट नाउ यू विल से कि ये क्या बात हुई, जंगल का राजा तो शेर होता है ना, एक मोटा हाथी ऐसा क्या कर सकता है? एक्चुअली हाथी हमेशा से ही नोमैडिक रहे हैं और खाने की तलाश में वो हमेशा आगे बढ़ते रहते हैं. वो रास्तों में कई चेंजेस लाते हैं. सड़े गले पेड़ के टुकड़ों को जमीन पे छोड़कर वो काफी डिस्ट्रक्शन करते हैं, जैसे फसलों को खाकर, पेड़ों को उखाड़कर, और इस डिस्ट्रक्शन को चेंज भी कहा जा सकता है. ये सारी गड़बड़ एक हाथी नहीं पर हाथियों का पूरा झुंड करता है. After all, they are social animals. वाह, कितनी similarities हैं हमारे और हाथियों में. Party करना and creating a mess after that. पर हैरानी की बात यह है कि this is nature's rare way of creating a jungle. पत्ते, branches and plants जो वो खाते हैं, जिससे gap create होता है, उसे पौधों की नई species बनने में मदद मिलती है. हाथी पेड़ों को उखाड़कर घास के मैदान तैयार करते हैं और जंगलों में जरूरी sunlight आने के लिए जगह बनाते हैं. हाथी जो सड़े गले पेड़ों के टुकड़े पीछे छोड़ जाते हैं वो कीड़े मकोड़ों के लिए खाना बन जाता है। और सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट बात यह है कि वो दूसरे जानवरों के लिए रास्ता भी बनाते हैं ताकि वहां से वो भी आगे बढ़ सके। तो जैसे हम अच्छे शहर बनाते हैं वैसे ही हाथी जंगलों को बनाते हैं। पर अब हाथियों की पॉपुलेशन घट रही है और जंगलों की भी। इंडिया ये गर्व से कह सकता है कि हाथियों की 50% पॉपुलेशन यहां रहती है। पर क्या आपको पता है कि 50% कितने होते हैं? 27,000 से 29,000 के बीच, that's it। और उनकी तादाद और कम होती जा रही है। इसको कंपेयर कीजिए हमारी पॉपुलेशन के साथ, which is constantly growing। जंगल सिकुड़ते जा रहे हैं और शहर बढ़ते जा रहे हैं। पर इसमें हमारी क्या गलती है? हम शहरों में रहते हैं, हमारे घरों में, away from the jungles, हाथियों को अपने हाल पे छोड़कर, है ना? गलत। पोचिंग और डिफॉरेस्टेशन के अलावा हम इंसान कुछ और कर रहे हैं जिससे हाथियों को कई डिफिकल्टीज को झेलना पड़ता है। हम उनके रास्ते में दीवार बन रहे हैं। ये कोई ट्रैफिक जैम नहीं जिसमें एक ट्रक ड्राइवर दूसरे रिक्शा वाले के साथ कुछ भी बहस कर रहा हो। यहाँ बात हो रही है उनका रास्ता रोकने की। हमारे हाईवेज, कनाल्स और रेलवे ट्रैक्स ने उनका रास्ता रोक दिया है। ये उन्हें डराती है और अपने नेचुरल ट्रेल से दूर रखती है। हाथी एक जगह बस नहीं सकते, बिल्कुल हमारी तरह। उनकी भी सोशल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज हैं, गर्लफ्रेंड्स हैं और उन्हें जंगल भी तो बनाना है। अगर हमें जंगलों की जरूरत है, अगर हमें क्लीन एयर, क्लीन वाटर, खाना, अगर हमें जिंदगी की जरूरत है तो हमें अपना ध्यान इस जानवर पर देना होगा जो ये सब पॉसिबल करता है। इन्हीं मैन मेड कंस्ट्रक्शन की वजह से कई हाथियों की मौत होती है। रेलवे ट्रैक्स और खतरनाक आप रोज ट्रैवल कैसे करते हैं ऑफिस के लिए?
सॉरी चिल्ड्रन, आई थिंक दैट एंड गॉट कट अ बिट, बट यू गॉट द आइडिया। डिड यू लाइक द एनिमेशन? डज इट कन्वे द मैसेज टू ऑल ऑफ यू?
यस सर,
यस सर,
यस
सर। सो एनीवे, द एंड ऑफ द एनिमेशन आल्सो व्हिच यू मे हैव मिस्ड अ लिटिल बिट, बट इट्स एग्जैक्टली व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट। बट रिमेंबर, दीज आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टूल्स टू कम्युनिकेट टू पीपल व्हाट इज हैपनिंग to elephants, right? But we have to also communicate to policy makers, to scientists, to bureaucrats, an IAS officer sitting there who will take the decision, or a Forest Service officer who will take a decision. So for them, we've also written books in which we have actually showed which are these 88 corridors. We thought there were 88 corridors in 2005. Then when we redid the book in 2017, we realized that number of corridors have increased. Is that a good thing, that the number of corridors have increased?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
No.
Yes, sir.
No. Sorry, wrong answer. Number of corridors increase when the habitat becomes smaller and smaller. If the habitats are larger, you don't need to connect them. You need lesser things to connect them. Okay? So it is good if the number of corridors where elephants can roam are more. That is true. But the number of corridors that are required to connect different habitats should be as few as possible. That means the habitats are big. So from 88 to 101, it has become because more and more habitat has been fragmented by a road or a railway track or something, and you are needing more corridors to connect them. Okay, so you can see that in various parts, we have got these maps. I don't want to go into detail, but each of these corridors, we have got number of threats. Again, I'm not going to read it out to you, but what I'm saying is that we have actually said that in this corridor, this is the threat. Is it agriculture? Is it human settlement? Is it highway? Is it mining? What is it? Okay. And from the 88 that we identified in 2005, 7 corridors are already finished. Elephants no longer use it. So in the difference between 2005 and 2015 or 20, in 10 to 15 years, we have lost 7 corridors that the elephants may have used 3 million years, or we don't know exactly how long, but it could be something like that, used for millennia, but now no longer used. Okay. So there are many ways to secure corridors, and I'll come to what you people can do as children, as students, but there are many other things that the people who manage our lands need to do. And we try to tell forest officers, we try to tell ministers, we try to tell policymakers what to do, to protect corridors. Okay, and we try to work with railway authorities and highway authorities to try and sensitize them. If you sensitize a train driver, no train driver wants to hit an elephant. Number one, it's a big risk for him and the train. But also, most of them feel very, very bad when they hit an elephant. So this is something they can't avoid. So you have to help them not hit an elephant by reducing the train speed, by developing animal detection systems, by doing patrolling on the tracks, all of which we are trying to do in some parts of India. We can't do it all over, but we are trying to do in some parts to show how it can be done.
You can see that this is a quiet
train driver. Train driver has seen the elephant. Now filming it with a mobile phone. Right. Similarly, in highways also, there are people now who are either we try to make overpass or underpasses, but these are very expensive and require hundreds of crores of rupees for national highways to do. So if we cannot make these overpasses or underpasses across, then we make people actually patrol that stretch, and when elephants cross, to stop the traffic on both sides. And such a simple thing can also help, you know.
Animals will come out the moment the car stops, and they run.
You can see now traffic is not honking the horn, they're not honking to move so fast. Instead, we have the click of the camera. Good. The people are at least trying to photograph the animals and not disturbing. 2 years ago, you can see a lot of honking, there's a lot of people trying to push the animals as they move the car forward. Now, they are waiting because they are volunteers who are guiding. See the number of animals coming up. I'm going to stop now, but actually, animal movement keeps continuing. So, after which, what we do is we try to secure each one of these corridors with 4 models. Either a private purchase model or a government acquisition model or a community securement model or a public securement model. Okay. And I'll come very quickly one slide of each. Yeah. Private purchase model is a very expensive thing, but we need to do it in areas where people are actually blocking the elephant movement right on in the middle of a very, very important movement path. Now, this connects nearly 10,000 elephants, 14,000 elephants actually, between Karnataka and Kerala, okay? And so this in Kerala, the corridors in Kerala, we had to actually relocate 37 families and purchase their land, build homes for them, make sure they're well settled and they're very happy, and then get the corridor declared as part of a sanctuary. And it takes years and years. This took more than 10 years to actually do, and we are still monitoring the corridor. We are still monitoring the people who have been relocated. And recently on Elephant Day, we released this publication, which shows how this can be done in a very sensitive manner to people, because you cannot just move people out of anything, whether elephant way or anything, without knowing what they really want. And so you have to give them all that they want and make their lives better. And you have to know what elephants want. So you cannot do this across India. You can do this in some places, very, very critical places where they're harming people and people are harming elephants. So you can see that people who lived in small huts were given large houses. And you can see that animals also then started frequenting the very areas that they were farming in. Another way is to make the government do it. This takes a longer time, but the government has more money and they can do it. But it needs the private sector like NGOs and civil society to help them, to give a soft hand so that people understand that this is not somebody just coming to throw them out. So this was done again in Rajaji, which is close to Delhi. So some of you can go and visit that place. But unfortunately, although we finished the human resettlement, there is still the question of the road. There's still the question of the railway line. There is still the question of an army ammunition dump. So there are things that the government still has to do to ensure that two parts of Rajaji are connected. A third way is in Northeast India, where the tribals own all the land, like in Meghalaya. The Forest Department of the government owns very little land. It's all tribal autonomous councils that own the land and the villagers themselves which own the land, in which case you can work with the village. And they set aside land. You're not buying land. You're not taking it away from them. They are saying, okay, 1/4 of my land I'm going to set aside for elephants. Okay? And some of them have set aside nearly 1/4 of the land. So here we are trying to connect Nokrek National Park to Balfakram Park. And all these villages, all those red dots that you can see, and there are a few more also. These are the red dots you see are the ones we have worked in already. But there are a few more that we need to work in to ensure that that spine, the green spine of Meghalaya, actually remains a spine and doesn't get vanished. Can you see the forest is just a narrow, thin green spine left in Meghalaya, the land of clouds, supposed to be dense forest. But the dense forest is only left in that little small patch. People have taken over the rest. So we are trying to protect that and allow elephants to move. And this is done totally through community. We are not buying land. We are just helping the community. Finally, I'm coming to that at the end of my presentation by saying what you can do. Yeah. The fourth part is to help protect the rest of the corridors where we don't need to move people, where there are no highways or no railways, but you can join a global campaign in India run by us as Gaj Yatra and Gaj Mahotsav, a rite of passage campaign, to try and tell people to build a social fence around these areas and help the animals move. Because eventually, I told you, the elephant is intelligent. So if you give it love, if you give it respect, the elephant will understand. And it will also give you love and it will also give you respect. Okay, it's a very important part of management. Today, you're chasing elephants. You're throwing bombs at elephants. They're intelligent. They understand your sentiment and they reciprocate that sentiment. Okay, so you can definitely join in a number of ways. There are a number of ways, whether it's art competitions, whether it's making elephants, whether it is planting trees, but do it as part of this campaign, doing it in specific areas which will create more impact rather than just doing it across India. We have got big artists to create elephants, some of which are in your school, which is what your director was talking about. Yeah, but you can create little pieces of like these children have created out of mud and clay. In fact, from the mud of the corridor itself, and then you can install it there. Right? Adopt a corridor. Make sure it moves. You can twin with other schools which are near the corridor. I know you are not, Sriram is not near any elephant corridor, very close to. But you can twin with a village school, which is near an elephant corridor, and help them by passing on your knowledge to less privileged people who actually are facing the brunt of elephants more than you are. And you can help them live better with elephants. In many parts of India where elephants are actually crossing, we have actually created boundary walls, school walls, hospital walls. We have made people paint. Don't waste paper. Paint right there on the wall, which is actually creating obstruction, so that people who are going through at least know that this is a place where elephants go, yeah, that elephants have right of way. And use your own art to paint the walls. I don't know whether you're allowed excursions, but this is something that you can even do if you have got an excursion possibility. Go to a nearby elephant corridor, the nearest you have, which may be in Corbett or Rajaji, and try to find a village which will help you paint walls. This is feasible. Or make the designs and let the village children do it themselves. I would not suggest that you use captive elephants too much. We have some captive elephants, 5,000 elephants. We don't know what to do with them. So Forest Service is using them. And I think till they die out, we are trying not to add to that herd. Let the Forest Service use them. But as tourists, don't use them. So I will request your director not to keep a live elephant, although she wanted one. Yeah, keep that lovely art piece. That's good enough to remind you. And go to the wild and see the elephant. That is far better. All right. And use, as you've already done, Sriram has already done wonderful work with WTI in using social media to spread the message and even to raise money. I'm very, very impressed And Rupa told me that she has worked with one of your schools to raise money for protecting corridors. It's extremely good if children take this step as well. So in doing all of this, we are ensuring that the elephant is not restricted to a small place. In this case, actual photo in Lansdowne in Uttarakhand of an elephant standing on top of somebody's roof. So you don't really want this to happen. The elephant has come on level land. It has not climbed the wall. It has come on level land. Suddenly it has found that somebody has built a home. That is the end of its passage. So this big, intelligent, loving animal that is the national heritage animal of India. The national animal is a tiger. But because of our cultural connections, it's a national heritage animal. Let us give it rite of passage. Let us give it a little more respect and love. And you will see that elephants will remain in India and survive in India longer than it does in many other parts of the world because of the strong connect that we have. We have to reduce conflict and increase the love, and your generation can make it happen. I am not a pessimist. I think we can make it happen. I'm a karma yogi. All of you should do your karma. And if you do little bits, yeah, at least don't do any harm. But if you can, do help. And don't just be aware by my talk or by seeing an elephant or attending a lecture. Do something. If that awareness turns to participation and some of you get involved in elephant conservation, the elephant will have a better future in India. Thank you very much, children. Thank you very much, teachers, for giving me the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you, Vivek, sir.
Thank you, sir. That was very informative and insightful. We now invite questions. You may raise your hands if you have a relevant question and only unmute yourself when your name is called out. Thank you.
Medha, we have Harshvardhan.
Harsh, you may go on.
Yes, namaste, sir. So my question was that after a corridor has been identified, so what is the best way through which it can be revived?
So that, Harsh, depends totally on which corridor it is. It is not a uniform solution. So each of these 101 corridors, we have got a conservation plan. So if you see the book called Rite of Passage, which is a little heavy reading, it is a technical book. But anyway, every corridor has a map and it has got a little box under it which says this is the conservation action that you need to do. So different corridors have different things. If it has a linear thing like a road or a highway, then we may ask for an underpass or an overpass or something like that. If it does not have that, you don't need that. Yeah, so there are different ways to protect corridors. Some of them, in fact, about 40-45 corridors actually are safe. There is no problem today. We don't want problems to happen, right? So it's only about 50 of them which need something to be done, 55 or something, which need something to be done, of which 6 or 7 we have already done, finished. Yeah, that's also joined the safe list. So the remaining has, each one has a different plan. Does that answer you?
Thank you, sir.
Now we have Anandita Agarwal. Anandita, please unmute yourself.
Thank you. Namaste, sir. Okay. So I want to know, to furthermore decrease the killing or poaching of elephants, would it be possible to cut the tusks of wild elephants or to even make false ivory to satisfy the demand?
Okay, very good question. I mean, nothing to do with what I talked today, because the whole thing about poaching and ivory trade is a whole talk. But I'll give you a short answer. Short answer is no. Blood vessels running right through it. Okay, so technically, like your tooth, like your molar, you can do an extraction. But nobody has done elephant teeth extractions. These are going to be very, very difficult to tranquilize the elephant and extract the whole tusk. If you cut it, it'll bleed to death. As simple as that. Plus, remember, the elephant has the tusk for a particular purpose. And the purpose is to feed. The purpose is to defend itself. The purpose is for mating. You know that female elephants like male elephants with bigger tusks in India. Yeah. So there are requirements of that tusk. So if you cut that tusk, you are stopping that animal to live a normal life. All right. The fake ivory thing also no, because the ivory is used for certain purposes in the Far East, and that cannot be today satisfied with fake ivory, although alternatives for many things are being tried as of today.
Thank you, sir.
Any more?
Meena, do we have Lakshay? Do we have Lakshay?
Yeah. Vrinda and Samarjeet had questions. If you're here, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah.
We also have Arya. Arya, you may go ahead.
So, sir, my question to you is, like, if an elephant, we have, poached it for tusk and it is still living after that, so will there be genetic changes for its baby?
So, if you poach an elephant, the word poach means kill. So, you can't poach an elephant and it will not be alive. Okay. The moment you say poach, it means the elephant is dead. So, and tusks cannot be removed without killing the elephant. So, elephants do not live if you remove the tusks. That is the end of the elephant. Okay. So, no question of genetics. But, your question, somebody may have told you something which has got some truth, which is if you take all the elephant with tusk and kill them, poach them, then the rest of the population will be tuskless. And therefore, it could have some genetic implications on future generations. It could have. There are studies in Africa which says that it has. But there are studies in Asia which says it does not have. Okay. So it is not conclusive yet because it depends on where the gene for the tusk lies. If the gene lies with the female, in Asian elephant, it won't make a difference because only the males are killed for the tusks. But the gene might still go from the mother to the offspring. So it's a complicated question, not a straight answer in terms of genetics.
Next, we have Samarjeet Malik. Samarjeet, please unmute yourself.
Yes, I'm audible.
Yes, you are.
So, sir, my question is, how do we model the habitat of elephants?
How do we model the habitat?
Yes, for elephants.
Model as in computer model?
No, as in like natural, like what are the basic requirements and the basic fundamentals behind that?
The basic fundamentals are that an elephant requires, what is a habitat if you ask? It's a place where the elephant feels safe, has food, has water, and can reproduce. Okay? If these four things are possible, that place is called a habitat. All right? Now, elephants are two things you need to know. One is that elephants don't need very dense forests. Elephants do very well in deciduous, open forests, scrublands, close to human habitation. They like open places with bamboo, with grass, and forest. They need grass, not just trees. So they need grasslands, they need a lot of water, they need... So bamboo groves are things that they like, okay? But just because it has the plants that it likes, it's not enough. It should have enough water. Just because it has food and water, it's not enough. It should have security. If the place is a place where poachers are coming often or other disturbances are there, they may move out. So if it has security, it has food and water, then elephants will live there and reproduce there and raise their babies there, and that's called a habitat.
Thank you so much, sir.
I think Veer from TSRS Vasant Vihar had a question. If you still want to ask, you please feel free to unmute.
Yes, sir. Sir, can you like cut off half the tusk and then the other half will still be there?
No, no. I just answered that to a previous question. No, you can't, because it has got blood vessels and nerves. You can't cut half the tusk. You can cut the tip of the tusk as they do in captive elephants. When they keep them captive, they do cut the tip off, but that's just the tip. It's nowhere near half. If you start cutting any more than two hand lengths, then you'll start bleeding, okay? And it'll cut the nerves and the elephant will bleed to death. So no, you cannot cut half. Any more?
I think we're good. So while we would have liked to have all the questions, we are short of time and must go on with our program. So thank you, sir, for answering all those questions.